In this episode of Finno-Ugric Machine, we are, well, it's electronics. It's about stepper motors and how to drive them. In the workbench I have now a setup which I can use to test the newly purchased stepper motor with a quite powerful driver, and then we need to make a pulse generator. Well, that's more than enough for one episode. So let's go into the workbench and start doing this. Okay, so let's start with this now. What I'm going to do here first is to solder some wire ends here, so that I don't first of all get electrocuted with this, and then that this won't dangle around. What I achieved here is this. Now this shrink thing here ensures that when this wire bends, it doesn't break from the soldering joint. This makes it a little bit stiffer. And now we have, this is our driver. It has, well, internal power supply. You can feed it with AC 220 volts directly. Well, I don't know whether this is isolated or not, and that's one thing I probably should check before doing anything with this. Let's see how, what kind of connections we have from the output to the input. Well, let's put it in the 200 kilo ohms range, so we can check from the line to the output. Seems to be nothing there. The other line, yeah, it's probably safe. Line 1, line 2, yep, and ground. Well, this ground is not... I'm using an isolation transformer. I have an isolation transformer there, and this ground is not used in this case because it's an isolation transformer. It doesn't have a ground. And then we have the two motor windings which should be connected there. And now, since we don't know about this, which is which, so we need to figure it out. So, okay, let's start with the red one. Red is promising. Which is connected to the red? The green one? No. Black? No. Blue? Blue is connected. It makes a beep. Okay, so these are one. And then we have the green, which should be connected to the black, and not to the other winding. So, green, black, and red, blue. I always forget this immediately when I red, blue. Yeah. So, yeah. Green, black, red, blue. It actually doesn't matter which order you put this, but the same winding should be on the same side. So here we have A plus A minus B, B plus B minus. So we have to take care that one, for example, the red and blue go to the B side, and the rest of the wires in the A side. But let's put like red to the A plus, and then the blue was the other end of that winding. Black goes to the B plus, and finally green to the B minus. we should configure this somehow. So this was a 6 amp stepper motor. So we have a table here. I will show a picture about this table. And there we can see that we can drive this up to 7 amps. Well, that we don't put it this way. So maybe we should limit it to the 4 amps. I believe that's... and peak is still like 5.6. That's a little bit much, I believe, because this has to be rotating in 100% duty cycle. So we take it a little bit lower. We choose RMS amps to 3.2 and 4.5 as peak amps. I think that's more like that. It's just a gut feeling. So, DP switch 1, which is the first one here. So, DP switch 1 should be on. It's on. Ah, it's already on. And all the others in off. Well, they are. All the others are in off. Okay, output current is now configured, maybe. And then we should configure the how it's input. And well, first of all, I would like to choose the lowest possible step resolution here. It's 200 steps per revolution. Wow. This means that for one revolution per second, it would be 200 hertz. Well, that's quite a low figure. So let's take 1 kilohertz is probably too much, but 400 hertz, that sounds a good one. So DP2 1, on, and then D4 off. On, on and off. Okay. Now it should be 400 pulses per revolution. Okay. Finally, configure how this reacts on the input lines. And we have a double pulse mode. Well, it means that we have the pulses which are input are 90 degrees out of phase. And then you determine which way it's going by the phase difference between those pulses, and this is not what I want to do. I want it to be a simple pulse in, and then direction, and then enable. So PU plus DR mode sounds promising. PU is pulse signal, DR is direction signal. Okay. DIP switch 5 on DP2 group 5, that one should be off. It's off. Good. And the rest, the final is okay. If this final, the 6th, is on, this doesn't accept any input, it just rotates it 30 revolutions per minute. Well, maybe we can test this with this one, but it's well, we don't. So D6 should be off, and it's off. I think we have configured it. Okay, so this is now my measuring equipment for this purpose. Okay, let's switch this on as well. Let's see if it's in the correct setting already. Yeah, it is. So what we are trying to do here is to feed our thing, the driver, with pulses. So I'm using sine wave actually as output, and this moment each of these squares presents 2 volts. So it is, well, about 2 point something volts RMS. 2, 4 and maybe 5 volts. So this one is a true RMS meter, It is telling me that the output is at the moment about 4 volts RMS, so this peaks about 5 volts at the moment. And you can change the frequency here. So what we are trying to do now, it was 400 pulses per revolution. Let's make it so that it turns 1 revolution per second. So this should be about 400 then. We should get there about, this is a frequency counter. Very precise thing. Well, it's about there. Now we have 400 Hertz coming out from this thing. Now, the moment of truth. Here we have the motor. This is the setup, as you can see, I try to put the oscilloscope and the measuring devices that are relevant at this stage on display. So this should, when I power this on, this should be turning like 1 revolution per second, so the speed should be about this. Let's see. Now it is connected. Let's try this out. Looks about right. Now it looks like we have 1 revolution per second. So the configuration is correct. There are two things that I can tell that it is so. Because, first of all, we have the correct speed here. So we have the pulses per revolution correctly configured. And then we have the correct wire setup because it's turning. And now I would like to try something with these two. So I have an external power supply here. So seems like 5 volts is more than enough for us. So let's put this to 5 volts. And now this should be minus. Well, our minus is... there we have one free minus. And then this goes to the supply minus, like that. Then we have the output plus here. And now this should be the direction. So when I touch this, it should change the direction. Huh. Nice. Okay, that works. Then I switch off the pulses. Like that. And now what I'm trying to check whether it is... Oh yeah, the power is there. It's gripping hard. So, if this is enabled, when I put my voltage here, it should stop gripping like that. Well, it's really important to... When it's stopped, it shouldn't feed the motor with the current. At least it makes some funny sounds. Let's see. Oh yeah. Now it's totally disengaged. And now it grips. Nice. So, if I put it like here, permanently, switch on the pulses, it shouldn't start turning. No, it did not. When I take this off, it starts right away. Okay, now comes the interesting part. I would like to check the limits of this. Okay, so let's see how fast we can turn it. Let's output some juice here. So, multiply by 10. Oh. Okay, that's pretty fast. Oh yeah. Let's do a little bit more even. Doesn't want to cooperate. So with this one we can check whether it... Okay, that's too much. So we can check what's our maximum speed when it starts reliably. Well, that's the speed when it starts reliably. Yeah. That's the maximum we can use and then it starts each and every time. So it's 1.1, well it's 2 revolutions per, well how much it's, 1.2 divided by 400, it's 3 revolutions per second, this one. Okay, that's the maximum speed we can get from this motor. Reliable. I know you can drive this like crazy. And it's still, but then you have to accelerate and decelerate or whatever. Well, okay. And now let's see about this. So, this is minus. There. Okay. Let's try just for the fun. If I get it turning. This is... No, it doesn't want to cooperate really. Well... You can use this kind of speed, it's now 6 kHz in, 6 kHz, this is, it's like 15 revolutions per second, I think. Oh, works. Next, I will deal with one of these. Soldering the surface mount components on this printed circuit board. I start with the microcontroller as it is the hardest component to solder. First I put some solder in the pad in one corner. And then I put the component, the microcontroller there, adjust it so that it's well aligned. And then I solder the opposite corner for that one. This way it stays in place. The next step is to put a lot of solder there. This goes in between the legs and the pads. After that, I will use my desoldering tool to get rid of the excess solder, and finally with heat gun and the pliers see that there are no whiskers in between the legs. Here I am checking that all pins are connected and that there are no shorts. There is one operational amplifier in this PCB, and it's easy to solder as it only has 8 legs and they are quite big. And then there are a lot of smaller components which all have a little bit different technique to solder them on.
The through-hole components are the last ones to be soldered in this PCB. First of all, this programming connector, it is, I'm using the female part in order to get it straight and well aligned when I solder. After it is soldered securely in place, I will just remove the female connector.
Okay, now that I have built this, the next step is to put some power into it. I have connected this to my adjustable power supply, and this one I can use to measure the voltages here. So that's our plus. And now let's raise the voltage just a little bit. Okay, just to 1 volt, so we can see where. Okay, it doesn't, it's not short-circuited, that's the first test, if it draws excessive current. And now this same voltage, 1.09 something, is also found here, and also there. Yeah. So now, this pin here should rise to 5 volts when I now gradually increase the voltage here. It should start pretty soon climbing, yeah. Hopefully you can see the meter here. I'm increasing the input voltage at the moment, so I can check how much voltage drop there is. This is the input voltage, which is about 4 now. So it's 25 volts, I believe. And now this should stop in 5 volts. Yeah, it did. So I increase it to the operating voltage, which is 12. And there should be, well, it's not exactly 12. Let's put to 12. So this should be now 5 volts. Okay. Then we have here, in this pin, we should have, so that when I decrease the voltage, this should suddenly drop. This is the power supply monitor circuit. Now it's dropping, and then around here, yeah. Okay, so this means that when this power supply is too low, like 4.6 maybe, then this pin stays low. It's the reset pin. And when we have enough juice, which is at the moment 4.69, there is a slight hysteresis in this one, so means that the power supply monitor is working. Very good. So we get an adequate reset signal for the microcontroller. Then we check that this AD converter here. This microcontroller has an AD controller that it has its power supply properly connected. So, yeah, it has. So, actually, there should be similar voltage in both sides of this little inductor here. And then, furthermore, we have here pins, which I now would like to check, that these are at 5 volts, each of them. They are. Then we have these inputs. These should be around 0, really low. Yeah, they seem to be 0 volts. So no leaks. It seems to be all right. Then we check these 4 small components here. MOSFETs, actually. So we can check the gate of these. that there is no excess voltage on those, so that they are off at the moment, and they are very nice. Well, I would say that I could try to program it. Of course, it doesn't have any program at the moment. I would program it, and after that we have a pulse generator here. Okay, here is the first test of this thing. I have connected it here. There is a power supply which I have adjusted, etc. Oh, yeah, this is not exactly the first, but I haven't modified anything. So you can see how I test this. So here are now the drives. This is pulse, this is direction, and this is enable. Now, when I started imitating a push button here, like that, you probably heard that strange sound. I already know the reason for that. And then you can adjust the speed. This is the lowest speed, and I believe this is too slow for any purpose at all. So maybe this one, because there is going to be a gear reduction, maybe 10 to 1. So this is really slow. This is too slow. So I believe this is something that might be, maybe, I don't know. I have to figure out what is the lowest speed. But then we have a problem. When I increase this, at some point we are going to get a lot of like steps. So the two fastest are like this, and this is well, that's too much of a step. I have to do something so that it acts linearly. Furthermore, if I now do such that I release this run button, this is run button going to be. So it's a foot switch that you push on, and now if I release it for a short time, just shortly, so it goes to full stop and then starts again. That's a bug. It shouldn't do like that. Furthermore, the direction change works all right. That is how it should work. So it slows down and turns. That's okay. Oh, now I lost it. Okay. Like that. That works. The reason why it is doing like this is that the enable, when you turn the enable off, it will take some, it has to be let to warm up this device. I believe you can actually estimate the amount of time needed here. It's about, I would say 700 milliseconds, maybe 500, half a second. Yeah, maybe half a second. So I will put the delay there, and what I have to change is this non-linear. This has to be changed. It's bad. Other than that, it's quite all right. So, this is now the version 2 of this software. And let's see what I have managed to do. First of all, I got rid of the quantization error. So, when I started, you can run it really slowly, like this, and then you can increase. There are no steps, no noticeable steps. There are steps, but you cannot find them there. And it's quite behaves itself here. this is now the maximum speed. I believe this is more than enough. I need to do it, let's see how I manage with that one. But this is the range that is most usable. So now what we have here is that when I stop it, it accelerates and decelerates quite well. But I managed to make a new error into here. First of all, now it doesn't change the direction like it should. I can change the direction while it's in standstill. And then when I run it, so that direction and that direction. But it doesn't change it while it's running. It should, actually. Furthermore, the enable seems to be so that you shouldn't be switching it off right away. You shouldn't disable this one because it does something strange. You should only switch it really off when it has been idle for, let's say, 1 minute or so. So then you should switch it off to avoid warming up this motor, because now it's now it's not holding, but and then you get this strange sound and okay. Anyway, not much to do, so I have to find the bug with the direction change. That's one. And then I need to fix this disable thing so that it it only switches disables this driver after maybe 1 minute idle. So you have been doing nothing here, so it switches off the power from the motor to keep it from warming up. So this is version 3 of the software in the brain box, and I think this is quite good, but let's see. I have also put these are going to be the switches I'm going to use with these. These are high quality Swiss made switches, push buttons, actually very neat. Okay, so first of all, this is the run switch, so let's run. Well, at the first time, now it was disabled, but now there is a 30 second delay before it switches it off again, so you don't usually get that funny sound with that one. So when you start it, it accelerates like that, and you can adjust the speed from very low like this. And you can increase it whatever value you like, for example that. And then, furthermore, you have this direction. When you are running it, you can change the direction. You can also pre-select the direction and run. Push again and it will run to the other direction. Okay. Furthermore, there are two more potentiometers here. This is the speed. I will put it high speed so you can better see what happens here. Okay, you see it slows down. But you can also adjust how long it takes it to stop. This is the slowest. It really takes some time. And yeah, then it stops. Ding. maybe if we demonstrate this with moderate speed, you can actually, with this one, you can make it a little bit faster, so that it almost stops immediately, like that. And the same applies how fast it starts up. You can make it so that it really starts, let's put a little bit more speed. So you can adjust both how fast it accelerates and how fast it slows down. So you can, yeah, okay, there you go, version 3 ready. Now just figure out the housing for all these. Well, okay, the stepper brain box is now ready to be used. All I need now is a good housing which will house the potentiometers, the switches, the stepper motor driver and the small brain box. After that, well, I think I will search for a commercial item which might be usable here. In the next episode we will be starting to make some gears for that one. I don't know exactly what will the gear ratio being, but I think something like 1 to 10 maybe. But we shall see about that in the next episode of Finno-Ugric Machining. Till then, see you!